Hello everyone. Today we talk about a progressive judgment by the Supreme Court on August 11, 2020. In the landmark judgment, the Supreme Court expanded on a Hindu woman's right to be a joint legal heir and inherit ancestral property on terms equal to male heirs. The court decided that the 2005 amendment of the Hindu Succession Act of 1956, which gives daughters equal rights to ancestral property, will have a retrospective effect since 1956. The judgment given by the three-judge bench, headed by Justice Arun Mishra, agreed with lead arguments made by Senior Advocate Biswajit Bhattacharya that the substituted Section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act 1956 confers the status of copersonor to a daughter born before or after the amendment of 2005 in the same manner as a son. Copersonor is a person who has a birthright to parental property. Let's see what is the Hindu Succession Act of 1956. The Hindu joint family and the Mitakshara copersonary, which is a subset of the former, are institutions where the rights of members are inherently unequal. Copersonary property is clearly a patriarchal concept that is firmly embedded in male entitlement to property by birth in a Hindu joint family. The Hindu Code Bill 1948 had abolished the concepts of Hindu joint family and copersonary and provided for a uniform scheme of inheritance of the property. However, this led to stiff resistance from traditionalists who feared that abolishing the Hindu joint family would lead to disintegration of the family and give rise to hostility and endless litigation. Hence, the Hindu Succession Act was enacted in 1956, which was a compromise document that adopted a midway approach between the complete abolition and total retention. It diluted the principle of survivorship, by which surviving copersonors share the property, and made some inroads to protect the property rights of female heirs who were proximate to the deceased male, such as widow, daughter, and mother. While this was a significant step, there were other gender discriminatory provisions that were enacted in the Hindu Succession Act 1956. The law applied to everyone who is not a Muslim, Christian, Parsi, or Jew by religion. Buddhists, Sikhs, Jains, and followers of Arya Samaj, Brahmo Samaj are also considered Hindus for the purposes of this law. As a step towards bringing about legislative changes in the succession law, Kerala abolished the Hindu joint family system in 1975 through a state legislation due to its inherent unequal nature. Further, Andhra Pradesh in 1985, Tamil Nadu in 1989, Karnataka and Maharashtra in 1994 too adopted a reformist approach. They enacted state amendments to the HSA to give daughters copersonary rights equal to that of sons and to eradicate the dowry system through positive measures of empowerment. However, this benefit was exclusively for daughters who were unmarried when the respective amendments of the states came into force. Future marriage of the daughter did not divest her of the property rights that had already been vested in her. Then came the 2005 amendment by the Parliament, which was applicable to the entire country and went one step further than the state amendments at infusing gender equality. Section 6 of the HSA Act was amended in the year to make a daughter of a copersonor also a copersonor by birth in her own right in the same manner as the son. The law also gave the daughter the same rights and liabilities in the copersonary property as she would have had if she had been a son. It thus enlarged the rights of daughters, recognizing them as copersonors for partitions from 2005 onwards, irrespective of their marital status. The law applies to ancestral property where succession happens as per law and not through a will. It recognized that exclusion of daughters from the copersonary rights contributed to gender-based discrimination and violated the fundamental right to equality guaranteed by the Indian Constitution. Now, coming to the current ruling in 2020, the main issue for determination by the court in Vinita Sharma versus Rakesh Sharma case was whether daughters could exercise their right as copersonors if the father was not alive on the date of the amendment, that is 9 September 2005. A three-judge bench headed by Justice Arun Mishra ruled that A Hindu woman's right to be a joint heir to the ancestral property is by birth and does not depend on whether her father was alive or not when the law was enacted on 9 September 2005. The court said, the conferral of a right is by birth and the rights are given in the same manner with incidence of copersonary as that of a son, and she is treated as a copersoner in the same manner with the same rights as if she had been a son at the time of birth. Thus, the current ruling emphasizes that the provisions of 2005 amendment are of retroactive application. Hence, whether the father copersoner had died prior to or was alive on the date of the amendment is not relevant. The court also directed high courts to dispose of cases involving this issue within 6 months, since they would have been pending for years. Now let's see, how did the case come about? While the 2005 law granted equal rights to women, questions were raised in multiple cases on whether the law applied retrospectively and if the rights of women depended on the living status of the father as of 2005 through whom they would inherit. Different benches of the Supreme Court had taken conflicting views on the issue, and different high courts had also followed different views of the top court as binding precedents. For example, in Prakash v. Fulwati case of 2015, a two-judge bench headed by Justice A.K. Goel introduced two basic criteria for applying the 2005 amendment to daughters. First, it held that a daughter cannot reopen a partition that took place prior to December 20, 2004. Second, the amended section would apply to the daughter only if her father was alive on the date when the amendment came into force, that is September 9, 2005. However, in the legislation, there is no express mention of the second condition of the living daughter of a living copersoner. Further, in February 2018, contrary to the 2015 ruling, a two-judge bench headed by Justice A.K. Sikri in Danamma and Others v. Amar and Others case held that the share of a father who died in 2001 will also pass to his daughters as copersoners during the partition of the property as per the 2005 law. However, in April the same year, yet another two-judge bench headed by Justice R.K. Agrawal in Mangamal v. T.B. Raju case agreed with the position taken in 2015. These conflicting views by benches of equal strength led to a reference to a three-judge bench in the current case. The ruling on 11th August 2020 now overrules the verdicts from 2015 and April 2018. It settles the law and clarifies and expands on the intention of the 2005 legislation to remove the discrimination as contained in the Section 6 of the Hindu Succession Act 1956 by giving equal rights to daughters in the Hindu Mitakshara copersonary property as the sons have. As far as the government's stand in the current case is concerned, Solicitor General Tushar Mehta argued in favor of an expansive reading of the law to allow equal rights for women. He referred to the objects and reasons for the 2005 amendment and submitted that the Mitakshara copersonary law not only contributed to discrimination on the ground of gender but was oppressive and negated the fundamental right of equality guaranteed by the Constitution of India. Now, coming to the impact of the judgment. First, the judgment in Vineet Sharma v. Rakesh Sharma case has ended years of uncertainty over the correct interpretation of the amendment of Section 6 of Hindu Succession Act 1956 done in 2005. Mitakshara law divides property into two types, unobstructed heritage and obstructed heritage. Since copersonary is a right by birth, it is unobstructed heritage, because acquisition of the copersonary interest is not obstructed by the existence of the owner of the property. The Supreme Court thus has correctly reasoned that since the 2005 amendment accorded daughters a copersonary right by birth, it is an unobstructed heritage, and so the existence or otherwise of the father at the time of the 2005 amendment is irrelevant. The second point is the effect on the state amendments. As per Article 254(1) of the Constitution, state amendments, if inconsistent with the central amendments, would be inoperative and the central amendment would prevail to the extent of the inconsistency. For example, After the 2005 amendment, all daughters would be entitled to copartenary rights, irrespective of their marital status, even in those states which had state amendments to the contrary. And hence now, Vinita Sharma judgment is binding on all courts across the country, wherein it is irrelevant whether the copartenary father was alive on the date of 2005 amendment or not. The court has explained that the 2005 amendment to section 6 of the HSA gives a right to daughters by birth in a Hindu copartenary. The right can be claimed prospectively on and from the date of amendment in 2005. However, it is based on the birth of the daughter, which is an antecedent event. Hence, the court clarified that the 2005 amendment has a retroactive effect. Retroactive statute or provision is the one that applies subsequent to its enactment, but its operation or application is based upon status or character that has arisen or been acquired prior to it, drawn from antecedent events. However, this reformative judgment is not free from practical limitations. Taking lessons from the incidents following the Sabarimala verdict of 2018, giving entry to women of all ages into the shrine, wherein females seeking entry into the temple following the verdict were manhandled. The current ruling lays down a rule of non-discrimination, for violation of which a daughter now has a right to approach the courts. However, the judgment would have practical significance only for a small section of daughters living in families belonging to the propertied classes. Given the increasing poverty, retrenchments and job losses faced by the Indian society in recent times, the property available for succession is itself considerably reduced to start with. Further, lack of awareness of rights, inavailability of human and financial resources, reluctance to antagonize their natal family, social stigma and victim blaming are all likely to deter the daughter from asserting her rights. Women are often persuaded to relinquish their property rights in the interest of peace and harmony in the family. A study by Landeza examined the implementation of the 2005 amendment in three states, Andhra Pradesh, Bihar and Madhya Pradesh. It finds that through deeply patriarchal social practices, dowry is substituted for daughters' land and inheritance rights. Since cash, jewellery and other consumables given as dowry are controlled and used by husband and his family members, the daughter is denied economic and social equality within the family. Interestingly, the study also found that the women are likely to inherit more land as a widow than as a daughter, and daughters, even when they inherit, are often not given equal share as the sons. The study hence called for key interventions in terms of reviewing the revenue codes, training the staff that implement the law, and oversight mechanisms at the state level to ensure effective implementation of the law. In short, the lesson that such empirical studies bring us is that while the Vinita Sharma judgment is a significant one, in order that daughters actually benefit from the judgment at the ground level, strategies need to be devised for addressing the social, cultural and economic barriers which are deeply entrenched in the Indian patriarchal society. Women are likely to be seen as threats to their natal families unless efforts at socio-economic empowerment of daughters as well as awareness-raising activities within their families are in place. Further, though constitutional principles of equality are being applied to the Hindu law of inheritance, the project is far from over because we have amended only the Section 6 of the Act and there are many more gender discriminatory provisions in the law. First one of them would be, the Hindu Mitakshara law of copartenary has traditionally given copartenary rights as a birthright to all male members of the Hindu joint family within three generations after the last holder of the property. In contrast, the 2005 amendment has only carved out copartenary rights by birth for daughters, not all women in the Hindu joint family. Second, the HSA has two separate schemes of succession for men and women, which the law governing succession of no other religious community has. In the case of women intestates, that means who have died without making a will, there are different schemes of inheritance based on the source of the woman's property, whether she has inherited from parents or from her husband or father-in-law, and the presence of children, which does not exist for male intestates. Indeed, women are not viewed as independent entities who are capable of acquiring, owning, and managing property. Third, agnates, meaning persons whose relationship is traced purely through men, are preferred over cognates, meaning persons whose relationship is not traced purely through men, even if the agnate is more remotely related. Fourth point would be, while full-blood relatives, where two persons are born from the same set of parents, is preferred to half-blood relatives, where the siblings share the same father but different mother, relationships by uterine blood, wherein the siblings share the same mother but different father, are completely ignored. To summarize, the Supreme Court has now set forth the idea that copersonary rights are birth rights free from limitations. As a natural corollary, property inheritance rights apply to all women retrospectively from 1956, which is the year of the codification of the patriarchal practices of the Mitakshara School of Hindu Law as the Hindu Succession Act. The judgment reiterates the idea that women are born as equals and that it is a patriarchal mindset and embedded customary practices and traditions that accord them an inferior status. Further, though some rampant gender discriminatory provisions continue to exist in HSA, the Vinita Sharma judgment can pave way for the necessary law reform processes to bring the HSA in line with the constitutional goal of gender equality. Moreover, what makes this judgment epochal is the progressive change in the attitude of the courts, which now appear to be upholding the principles of substantive justice for women, both in theory and in practice. The higher judiciary in India has been recently breaking stereotypes, be it the Sabarimala verdict of 28 September 2018 or granting permanent commission to women officers in the Indian Army on February 17, 2020. Though we can be glad that on occasion the law and courts may turn out to be progressive, we cannot be overtly hopeful about the patriarchal Indian society to agree to the progressive reforms as we had seen following the verdict of Sabarimala. Moreover, the challenge for economically dependent women in far-flung rural areas who are denied literacy, dignity, and sometimes even a name and identity in securing their rights is immense. Family histories have conveniently wiped out any references to women and what their lives were like, what became of them, and how they managed to survive in the absence of support from husbands and children. And that's all for today. Thank you.